delighted to welcome amongst us today Professor Wester from the LSE to speak on, you know, what restless empire China and the world in 1950s. Professor Wester is very well known as to us as a historian in political sciences and commentator on international affairs. And he's something of a bestseller because U.S. presidents and president hopefuls keep reading his books. So I think we also should, in case any of us haven't. Not only has he covered the whole 20th century in one way or the other, in the study of the Cold War, the books he's written and the books he's edited. But today we are fortunate to have him talk about his latest book, which starts off in the 18th century. So, when China was at its peak in the middle of the 18th century, late 18th century, and what happens after that, and to bring the story up into the 20th century, and something that will be very close to our hearts, what happens in the relations with India, we must sort of inspire him to comment on these matters which one of our great obsessions. So, not only the history, but also the 20th century, we would be hearing about and discussing this afternoon. So, may I call upon Professor Wester?
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me to be invited. To New Delhi, to India, to the Nehru Memorial Library. It's a visit that I've been looking forward to for some time. The main reason why I'm here is to try to carry out some of my own research on a new book that I'm doing on the global history of the Cold War, which tries to look at the Cold War in a comparative perspective, trying to look at it up against other international orders that have developed over long periods of time, really within a 100-year perspective. And it's key, therefore, to be able to deal with the Indian experience of this, going back to well before independence. India's role in terms of global international affairs is something that, in my view, is very often underrated. And it's underrated for the main reason that so much of what we write about international affairs is state-centered, meaning that India, in the period when it was still without its national independence, didn't really figure in what many historians of international affairs write about. What I find, to the contrary, is that India, since the late 19th century, had a very significant impact on world affairs in a broad sense, that it's very often missed out in terms of how people write international history. And in part, that brought me to India on this occasion, which I'm trying to resurrect in terms of the materials that I'm looking at here. Now, on the China book, why did I want to write this book in the first place? There's a question that I often get when I'm asked about it. Well, I wanted to do what you could call a China-centered history of Chinese foreign affairs. I didn't just want to see China in light of what had happened elsewhere. I wanted to look at it in terms of the sources and in terms of the materials that now become available in Beijing and elsewhere, what has been identified, what is available for scholars. I think it's important to underline, since we are here in the Nehru Memorial Library, and since I was working in the Indian National Archives this morning, the wealth of material on Chinese foreign relations that has become available over the last maybe 6-7 years, as Beijing have introduced a somewhat more liberal approach to access to official and unofficial documents. And I think it's important in many ways that countries, including India, move in that direction. It's very hard to do history, particularly history of international affairs, if you do not have broad access to the kind of material that you can build it on. what you'll end up with then is very often, as has happened with China, until very recently, that you get histories of the country written from the outside, based on someone else's documents. And that is not, as even the Chinese found out after a while, a very smart position to be in. So this is a sense of orientation, a sense of interpretation, and availability of materials come together at the same time. That is what made this book. Now, if you want to start talking about China, just like if you want to start talking about India, or any other very, very big country, you don't have to come up with a definition of what the country is. And I'm always being pushed on this by my students. What is this China that you are talking about? And it's not a self-evident question. I mean, the boundaries that China has have changed all the time. The cultural focus of China have also changed all the time. We're a much deeper historical path than the 250 years that I'm talking about in this book. There are many competing, to some extent, hybrid interpretations of what China is today. And here is mine. For what it's worth. And it is also a broad one, but it's one that I found to be of much use in terms of my approach to understanding Chinese affairs. China is a culture, and a state, and a geographical core. And around this, different identities and boundaries and definitions of purpose have shifted and adjusted for a very, very long time. The idea of the being in China is something unchangeable. Something, if you use that term, traditional, that simply seems to never change over time, is a misconception, in my view. China, the way we see it today, and the way we see it, also see it, throughout the period that I'm looking at, is something that emphasizes change. It emphasizes, as I say in the title of my book, restlessness. And it's this changeability, movability that I want to emphasize around the different interpretations of the Chinese core, as it were. That is, if there is one central message in terms of approach in the book, that is it. But having said that, and I'll develop this a little bit further in a minute, there are, of course, also concepts and perceptions that, even though they change and develop over time, have aspects in them that have carried over from deeper history, going much beyond the 250 years that I cover in this book, and perhaps 2,000 to 3,000 years back in time in some cases. And let me just list three of these, because they have a significance, I think, for anyone who tries to understand Chinese foreign affairs today. At least they had a very great significance for me when I was writing this book. The first one is a certain concept of justice. And when I say justice, I don't mean distributive justice, as we often think about it. I think it's slightly different forms in Europe or in India. I'm thinking about justice in terms of order, in terms of how countries, how states, how societies are treated. When China made its first entry into a Western sense of world order in the early 19th century and up to the mid-20th century, I think there was a deep self perception in China that the country was treated very unjustly, very unfairly. Its rightful place was taken away from it. It was reduced somehow. And that was unjust. It was not the way things were supposed to be organized and supposed to be the order. Of course, this is a concept that doesn't just have to do with the relationship between states or among societies. It also has to do with relationships between individuals, between families, and with groups within the state. But it's very detailed, and it's very significant, I think, for many Chinese. Not just in the current interpretation, China has been treated very unjustly by the West for a very long time, and now it's trying to make good on that. Also in terms of the deeper concepts that go into this, that justice is something one ought to search for, one ought to deal with Chinese is the principle of ni, the principle of an ordered form of justice, or a principled form of justice, is something that international society has strived to. Then secondly, in terms of these concepts and perceptions coming out from the deep past, there is a sense of rules and rituals. Now, far too much has been done of this in a very narrow context by historians who have been looking at China. You know, kowtowing to the emperor, this kind of stuff. The Chinese are so preoccupied with form that they don't really see content, which in my view is wrong. That is not what this is about. It is more about regularization, systematization, of international affairs, among other things. A search for a world that is better organized, more predictable, and therefore more easy to deal with, than the world that China has seen as it transited out of its own Sino-centric East Asian order and over onto the global order in the 19th century. I'm fascinated by the Chinese encounter with Western-based international law in the 19th century, which is something that many Chinese intellectuals embraced in the 1870s and the 1880s, only to find after a relatively short period of time that this was something that the Western states, that themselves had come up with this, and Britain especially, didn't really take seriously when they were dealing with the areas outside of Europe. They barely took it seriously when they were dealing with areas inside of Europe. Which I think to the Chinese was a profound shock to the system. They thought that they were entering into a world that, even though it was set against them, still operated according to certain rules. And the shock of this being a rather anarchic international order was something that the Chinese leaders then and Chinese leaders today find very hard to swallow and find very difficult to accept. So that's what I'm talking about when I talk about rules. It's not something culturally predefined that cuts you off from the world around you. It is about a certain idea of how rules can be applied internationally. And then finally, and you can't get around this, is what you may call a sense of centrality on the Chinese side. As some of you will be aware, the current Chinese name for China is Zhongguo, meaning, depends on how you want to interpret it, the central empire or the central kingdom. It's an ancient concept for China. It really means, if you think about how it was used 2,500 years ago, it means the central core within China, out of which so much of Chinese culture came, the area along the Yellow River Valley in the north. But it's extended to be the name for the whole country, and now it may not be etymologically connected to a sense of intercultural centrality. That is the way it's come to be played, I think, over the last 1,000 years or so. And the reason for this is, of course, very clear. In a way that is similar to India, though not identical, China is, at its origin, a cultural country. And it is a culture where very significant parts of it have been taken up by the world around China, by countries like Korea, Japan, Vietnam, and elsewhere, in terms of the writing system, in terms of much of the written culture in general, in terms of some of the central ideas for how you organize society and how you organize the state. And it's this spread of Chinese culture, the idea of being a center within a much larger cultural region, that to me is the centrality that we are talking about traditionally with regard to China and what we are talking about today. It is not the idea that the Chinese are special in a sense of setting apart from everyone else in the world, or that the world ought to be organized in a way that China is the center. It is about the region, in a relatively narrow region, and a region that has been infused in the past by Chinese culture. It's that regional setting that centrality is about. That doesn't make it less important. In a way, if you look at the relationship today between China and Japan, or between China and Southeast Asia, it makes it more and more acute and more difficult to handle in many ways. So those are three of those long-lasting concepts that I deal with in the book and for most of the deeper thoughts, and find their various modern incarnations. Concepts of justice, rules, and a sense of centrality. What I'm writing about in the book, though, most of the chapters that are there, is about how many of these concepts have been challenged from the mid-18th century forward, and how they often show up in forms that are rather surprising in terms of how things work in a broader sense. But I'll talk more about that in a minute. Let me first just give you a sense of how the book is put together. When I write, I very often think of it as a form of craftsmanship. A book is not just about ideas and concepts. It's also a rather practical thing. You have to put it together in a way that makes it meaningful for more people than yourself and your closest relatives. You would have to read it anyway. And it might not, but I mean, it must have been an ideal world there for you. So it is not just a book about foreign relations in a narrow sense. It is not just about diplomats and warfare and high politics. As many historians of India have been among the first ones to underline over the last generation, the history of international affairs is much broader than that. So this is about immigrants and emigrants. It's about businessmen. It's about missionaries. It's about other people who travel back and forth and in and out of China. One guy who plays a key role in the book is a guy called Wang Hong, I think mainly known outside of China as Yong Wing, who was the first Chinese who graduated from college. He graduated from Yale College, as it was back then, in 1854. So this is about a number of people who have gone abroad, some cases then returned to China, and have influenced the way China looks today. It's also, to quite some extent, and we mentioned that since we are in Delhi, about Indians who played a role in Chinese history. And this is something that really comes up in terms of China itself and in terms of Southeast Asia, in terms of all the Chinese networks that developed in various parts of the world. And I was just making this argument to someone I was talking to yesterday that if you look at Shanghai, by far the biggest and most dynamic city in China in the early 20th century, a lot of the people who run that city are Indians or people of Indian origin. In terms of its intellectual life, in terms of its business life. The four richest people in Shanghai in the beginning of the century all had some kind of Indian background in them, although in a couple of cases to Iraq and other places within the British Empire. So this is a book about different groups of people who in many ways can come together and contribute to this global China, as you can call it. It underlines, of course, a certain period in Chinese history. Again, I'll get to this at the very end of my talk today, which is about openness, which is about linking up to the rest of the world. Part of my argument in the book is that the periods in Chinese history for these 250 years that I cover, where China has been closed off, where China has been inward-looking, are very few and far between. China, for the most part, during this period, has been looking outward relentlessly, and to a degree that most other countries in the world have not. So, if I'm dead wrong, anyone who teaches, at least anyone who teaches history, ought to be asked by their students. So, Professor, what is your interpretation of Chinese international history over these past 250 years? And in this case, I must say I have to disappoint them that there isn't a real interpretation is. It's very hard to come up with an interpretation of something that lasts for 250 years and is still ongoing. But I think there is a significant position in it, which is slightly different. A position that influences the trend of the story that I want to read in this book. And that significant position is as follows. The making of modern China was a metamorphosis. And what we're looking at today is a hybrid. It's a hybrid society and a hybrid state, created from domestic and foreign influences alike. That element of modernity is probably stronger in China than in most other countries that I know. It has to do with the openness that I talked about already. But it also has to do, of course, with the very unruly history that China has gone through since the mid-18th century. Very violent in parts. Very challenging for people who had to try to deal with the various transformations that this country went through. But what all of these generations that I look at have in common is that in some way or another, they have succeeded in living through that transformation and at the end of it, embracing it, making it their own. And if there is one thing that I think very particular people here in India ought to understand about contemporary China, or China today, it is that the power that has been created out of this embracing of change. So, what I try to do away with in the book, and I already alluded to this, is the sense of China as being static, of a China that always returns to its own roots. And in order to get an American audience on board, and this book was primarily published in the United States, I often draw the comparison, which I think is less accurate, between the United States and China. These two countries are much more in common than what, thank you, than what most people realize. If you compare it to relatively old-fashioned parts of the world, like Europe, or to some extent like India. Both United States and China is about change. It's about relentless change, about relentless reinvention of most things that are around. About influences that come in from abroad, that influences health very deeply, in which everything seems to be changeable. Where personalities, where approaches, where points of view, where information orders, when even people's names may change, and change very quickly, but in a form that is seen as being valid, useful, and therefore accessible. For a very old-fashioned European like myself, this can be a bit dizzy in terms of the modes of change and the intensity of it. And the comparison with the United States, in its slightly different form as an immigrant society, is not entirely far-fetched, particularly if you look at the 19th and 20th centuries. Now, in order to understand this, I think, and it is a lot of talk about this book that I like to stress, in order to understand this, you have to go back in history. You can't just deal, as many historians do, with the 20th century, or if they are centered on Europe, especially in Britain, with the 20th century and part of the 19th. You have to go further back in time. And I wanted to set this book up in a way that caught the significance of the last great dynasty to rule China, the Qing, or bright, glorious, as they like to call themselves, dynasty. And the significance that it had within the region from the mid-18th century onward. And it is particularly important, I think, for my Chinese audience, because there are many in China who have deep difficulties, substantial difficulties with understanding. There was nothing backward. There was nothing inward-looking. There was nothing insular about the Qing dynasty, the Qing Empire, in the mid-18th century, when my story begins. This was an outward-looking, expanding, and aggressive empire, which had, over the 50 years that preceded the period where I saw my story, taking control of its region, more or less in full. I think if you told any other Asian that China in 1860 or thereabouts was inward-looking and insular, you would be sent off to have your head examined. I mean, anyone who got into contact in any form with the Qing in the mid-18th century, well up against the very formidable challenge, including, by the way, the Russians, who were trying to stake out their own empire in the northern part of Asia. If you look at that relationship, there's never any doubt about who's in charge. The change is not just expansionist, they're also armed to the teeth. And they are very warm if you come up against them in any form of direct contact. Now, the reason why it's important for me to underline this is that the idea of this gradual thickening of China, of China then being overtaken in a way by Western countries, and first and foremost Britain, in the 19th century, is a story that you have to modify somewhat. Now, it is important that the Chinese state got weakened from the late 18th century onwards. Mainly, in my view, for internal reasons, which I can go into when we do our Q&A afterwards, but there's no real place here. But the significance of the change in terms of its international context remains in place for a very, very long time. And you can go up to the early 20th century and you can see how Koreans, for instance, talk about the centrality of China in a way that assumes that that centrality will be there forever. I looked a bit at this after I finished this book, and it's truly fascinating to see how many Koreans, or Vietnamese for that matter, look at China as the lodestar of the cultural universe in which they inhabit, long after the political and military power of the Qing is gone within the region. What is central to me is that as the state weakened in around 1800, which is a good timing for it in my approach to the way I see things here, there are a number of economic and social transformations that are taking place within China. Some of them start before the Western impact really starts to be felt, and they continue after that. Some of them originate with the Western incursions and take off from there. But with, again, this hybridity that comes in terms of the process of change that really belongs in the 19th century as a whole. And it's incredibly important to catch this in terms of understanding how China develops. The weakening of the state in international terms meant opportunities for many Chinese to take part in a different kind of world and a different kind of activities than they ever been able to do before. From the late 18th century onwards, you have Chinese being an integral part of the imperial systems that were developing, particularly to the south, but also to some extent to the east. Starting the supply lines, starting the market lines of these various empires, not just the British empires, but also the French and the Dutch, to a degree that much of what is international in China's 19th century comes in through the various links that are established in this form. The weakening of the Qing state also opened up opportunities for talent, which is something that I look at quite closely in the book. The number of people who moved from China, which is not very significant if you compare it to the European population of the world, which happens roughly at the same time, but had a deep impact in some parts of the world. First and foremost, Southeast Asia, of course, but also in other parts. I mean, parts of the Pacific, parts of South America. And I looked into the history of Chinese who settled in South America and the Caribbean quite closely for it, because it is truly a fascinating story. Even though the number of Chinese who left and went abroad numbers for the 19th century roughly 1 to 26, if you compare it to Europeans, it is still an important history of emigration, because just like in India, many of these people, the people who emigrated, not just themselves, but their daughters and their granddaughters, come to influence China itself very significantly during the century that was to follow. I use as one example here a a Trinidadian-born Chinese, Yuxin Chen. Chinese father and Trinidadian Creole mother, who came back to China, back in double quotation marks, both either he or his father had ever lived in China, but came to China in the 1970s. So three times a Chinese foreign minister, without ever learning a word of the language, and had a very deep impact in terms of how many Chinese understood international affairs in the interwar period. His son, I have to mention this, although it is a tangent, his son became a communist very early on, joined the Comintern, and ended up perishing in Stalin's purges under the name Sergei Yevgenovich Chang, born Percy Chang in Trinidad. What happened? I also emphasize the links that are there. These are very, very important to me in terms of the translation of perceptions of science and technology in China in the 19th century. If you want to understand China's internationalization, understanding these transformations are of very great significance, just like they are in India, by the way. The thing that is most important for me there is that I think this happened in a period that is not too dissimilar, chronologically, from when it happened in the rest of the world. We have a tendency to think about Chinese modernity as a relatively new thing. Well, I mean, for most of the world, including most parts of Europe and most parts of North America, there isn't that much of a difference in terms of time. The urbanization, the modern urbanization, the modern industrialization of China starts in the late 19th century. And the transformations of ideas and attitudes belong very thoroughly within that time period. The transition, if you like, from magic to science in terms of how one understands it. Understands the world. And it's roughly at the same time as this would happen, so for instance, for my grandparents. Were born on a tiny little farm in the west of Norway, again, Vidarøy, and were drawn into a industrial society that was just developing in the nearest city from where they were. They went through the same transformation as millions of people did elsewhere in the world, and millions of Chinese did roughly at the same time. My favorite way of explaining this is the great Chinese writer some of you would have heard of, in Guomuro. And in his autobiography, he tells the story of one of his science teachers. This must have been around the turn of the century, around 1900. Who is reading a brand new translated text of astronomy, which he's using to instruct his students. So going from what he had learned in school, which was a very Chinese way of understanding the skies and the heavens in terms of how they operated, and over onto one that came out of the newest Chinese printing press in Shanghai, of course, connected to printing presses in London and Manchester, not to mention Bombay and Calcutta, and to some extent Delhi as well. But the problem for this guy is that he realizes it is mid-past, so he misreads one of the characters. He misreads the second character of the expression Jianran Jingxiang, natural conditions, as Jianlong Jingxiang, the appearance of heavenly dragons. So then he starts interspersing his science lecture with manifestations of celestial creatures floating through the sky before he jumps back to his Manchester style astronomy lecture. These are the kinds of transitions, you could use many examples of them, that happen not just within one generation, not just within one decade. They may happen within a year of a person's life. That rapidity of transformation is essential for understanding the modern condition in general, as I've written about in a slightly different context. And it's particularly important for China. But it's China being universal in this respect that is important for the point that I'm making. So for me, the history of Chinese modernity is in many ways the history of China's involvement with the outside world. In the book, I see this in three phases, broadly speaking, when you talk about the last 100 years or so. I see what one great historian, Frank Decker, now at the University of Hong Kong, calls China's Age of Openness, the period when China is really at the peak of its adaptability in terms of the outside world, from the 1880s and up to the 1930s. And then the Soviet era, very distinctly Soviet era, not just because of the collaboration between the Chinese communists and the Soviet brethren, but also because of the Soviet Union being manifested as the form of modernity that many Chinese chose to embrace. Going from the 1840s, roughly, thereabouts, and up to the 1980s, long beyond the period, by the way, when China and the Soviet Union had a political break under Mao Zedong's time in power in the early 1960s. Soviet models of development, the Soviet style path to modernity, was something that the Chinese clung to long after the political relationship had, not to mention the military and diplomatic relationship had broken down. And then in the American era, from the 1980s and up to today. And I use the term American very deliberately. I mean, Chinese don't like this at all when I use that. So they like to talk about China's internationalization, or the idea of Kaifeng, the reform and opening era. That's not what it's about. It is about very large-style Americanization. The model that China chose in the 1980s is not as much international as American. And it's really based to a very high extent on the incorporation into Chinese life in very many different ways of American models. On anything from a new style of education, to management, to business practices, the significance of these American models is great for China. And the more China criticizes the United States, the more interested the Chinese, official or otherwise, seem to be in adopting those American models to what they see as Chinese realities. But there's a point there. It's a very banal kind of point, but it's important for those of us who want to be international history. The way you can tell that diplomacy or even warfare doesn't mean everything in terms of international relations is looking at what people do. I mean, how they behave, what they want to link up with. Not just through music and style and choice of words and terminology, but how they want to live their life. What they define themselves, voting with their feet, in terms of what a good life is. That is much more significant in many ways than most things that have to do with warfare or diplomacy. Now, within this time period that I cover, is manifest. There are also what you could call key moments, I mean key sort of long-term events that seem to point towards today's China. So let me just dwell on a couple of those, and now I'll finish up by talking about some of China's foreign policy challenges today. One key moment for contemporary China is the encounter with Japan. And a point that I make in the book is that the significance of that relationship can barely be overstated in Chinese terms. It's not only about conflict. Again, get rid of that idea, that the relationship between China and Japan is about relentless conflict. There have been as long periods of cooperation and mutual admiration in the relationship between the two over the past 150 years as there have been intense conflict. The early Chinese revolutionaries who set up the Chinese Republic did so mostly from Tokyo, mostly inspired by different forms of Japanese modernity that they embraced wholeheartedly. Sun Yat-sen, the founding father of the Chinese Republic, when asked about what was the most important thing that the young Chinese could do to help his country, as late as 1914, said to learn Japanese. And there is something very clear in this, in terms of the idea of the adaptability of Japanese models that could be used for concise, specific Chinese purposes, including, by the way, Marxism. I mean, the way Marxism developed in China is as much, if not more, a Japanese import than what it is a Russian import, at least up to the mid-1920s. But there is, as you may gather, also something that is fundamentally problematic in the relationship to Japan, and I've alluded to this already. It is this idea that Japan has somewhat, in a non-righteous, unjust form, subverted and attempted to take over China's national place within the bigger region. This is something that, in cultural terms, is very difficult to get rid of. And it's part of the reason why the relationship between the two is so intensely difficult today. And you understand this better through some forms of psychology, I think, than through much of international relations. It's about displacement, or cultural banishment, or whatever way you want to see it, depends on which discipline you understand. Second one, I won't dwell on this because I mentioned it already, is the role of the Chinese diaspora. An ongoing process of enormous significance. When China started turning outward again after the disastrous Maoist experiment, the third place it turns is towards the Chinese experience in Southeast Asia. And the slowly to lessen degree towards Japan happens roughly at the same period. The first foreign visit that Deng Xiaoping makes after having become German disputed leader of the party in 1978 is to Singapore. I've just been able to get hold of the transcript of his meeting with Lee Kuan Yew, the Singaporean Prime Minister, which are truly fascinating, because it starts out in the sort of general diplomatic style with interpreters and all of this. And then Deng interrupts Lee and says, you know, I've been here once before. I came through here in 1920 on my way to Marseille, on my way to France. Then this was a poor country. Now you're rich. Tell me what happened. So this turns into a 2 times 5 hours long seminar between two people who, of course, crucially, both are Hakka in origin, come from a South Chinese minority. There's a direct connection between the two in those backgrounds, which is truly important. And I think this is the kind of link in terms of inspiration, in terms of models, but not just for the good, by the way, certainly not always in terms of what China can import from Singapore, but in terms of the profound understanding, including very much in Singapore, that Chinese abroad have been able to build something extremely valuable, something that China can learn a great deal from. And on that, I think the current leadership is entirely correct. Then finally, the 1970s as a great turning point in terms of contemporary Chinese history, in a way, the real Chinese revolution, one that may be more significant for us to look at when we look back 100 years from now than either 1911, 1912, or the Communist Revolution up to 1949. And the reason I'm saying this is the remarkable speed with which China moves out of one system of organizing things, broadly speaking, and over onto another one, which sets the country on the path to the global position that it has at the moment played within, in my opinion, the world. So far, or the LSE, will be the biggest economy in the world within 5 to 6 years. That is a stunning reversal, a stunning transformation, which historians and others who try to understand things historically are still trying to get to terms. And it's very difficult to understand what happened. I mean, in my view, you have to look at it not just from above, you also have to look at it from below. You have to look at it in terms of what happened in the provinces, you have to look at it as a reaction against what has gone before. In some cases, I think it makes sense to interpret it, we can talk about this later, about the market of the revolution, and it's particularly important in southern China. But it is a transformation that is on such a scale that it probably is the most important transition that China has gone through in the 20th century. Which leads me to today. And let me just make a few observations about what I see as the biggest Chinese challenges for today's international affairs, and I include some points about India here as well. But the starting point for anyone who looks at China's international affairs today has to be its near region, which means borders and neighbors. If China is moving anywhere over the next generation, in my view, it is in terms of its establishment as a regional power. There are many Chinese who may have ambitions that look beyond this, but both in terms of intention and in terms of capability, that is not where the Chinese gains will be. It will be at trying to set China up as the center of its own region in a very decisive way. But that would be problematic. I mean, you can already see that. I mean, how this means China into conflict, not only with Japan, but also increasingly with the countries of Southeast Asia. Chinese foreign policy, and I've said it in Beijing, obviously, with a lot of officials who couldn't be seen on camera nodding their heads behind me. Chinese foreign policy towards Asia, towards Southeast Asia over the last 2 years has been absolutely soft. And it's the closest you can get to manifestation of Chinese overreach in terms of the position that it's now got in perceptual terms internationally. That the 2008 economic crisis seems to have weakened the rest of the world. China has been able to weather the storm so far. It therefore is in a position of its own. It's in a position to do things it couldn't do before. And what many countries do in that kind of position, learn here from the United States, is to overreach, is to enter into conflicts that are both unnecessary and unwanted, but which come out of perceptions of what can be done that are almost entirely false. Since Deng Xiaoping, China has spent a generation building up a good relationship with most of the countries in Southeast Asia. It was Deng's greatest foreign policy victory, and one that he was immensely proud of. What has been happening now through the relentless Chinese focus on completely indefensible and impractical lines of control in the South China Sea is to throw away much of it. So watch that. Watch it also in relation to India. I don't think there is any reason to believe that Sino-Indian relations over the next 10 years or so will necessarily be very contentious. In fact, the two countries have both, for their own interests, a great deal to gain from working together, not least in economic terms. And as all of you will be aware, more than me, China's significance as an economic partner for India has been growing very, very rapidly. There is also complementarity between China and India in the economic sphere that is quite strong. And it is not just the oldish kind of saying about India being good on software and China being good on hardware, although there is something to that way outside the IT understanding of the world. It also has to do with the potential for economic integration in a much broader sense. But where the potential conflicts are, of course, with regard to borders, and there are reasons to be concerned over some of the border issues. Again, you would be more aware of this than me. There are reasons to be concerned about what happens outside India's and China's immediate home zone. The conflicts in Southeast Asia, over Southeast Asia, may easily end up relatively soon becoming a point of conflict between China and India as well. Those are important, but they're not the main. My two main concerns is with mutual protection and with the role of Pakistan, which is one of China's and India's biggest foreign policy challenges. If I just a few words about China and Pakistan first. On the Chinese side, the relationship with Pakistan, although undoubtedly very close, is also seen as problematic. I mean, it's interesting when I speak to people in Beijing at fairly high levels that North Korea and Pakistan very often come up in the same paragraph, as it is. As countries that oversee as strategic assets for China, but as seen from within the Chinese leadership, are not necessarily assets, more problems. I mean, after all, if you look at North Korea specifically, if you want to be a leading international power, and you have one formal ally in the whole world, and that ally is North Korea, you don't have an asset, you have a problem. And Pakistan, in spite of the many things that linked it to China, and after the whole development from the 1960s onwards, it's not just anymore about security or even investment or the potential thereof in the far future. It's also about sentiments and emotions and things that bring the two countries together. is also, in the practical world, a bit of a problem. It's a problem that Charles doesn't really know how to handle. I think it's important that this is understood in Delhi. On the one hand, India is far more important for Charles than what Pakistan is, whoever will. I don't have to enumerate the reasons for it. But on the other hand, there are some, opinion this is very divided, there are some who believe that the Sino-Pakistani relationship is something that doesn't just further stability in the wider Chinese border areas, or for that matter in South Asia. It is also something that in the longer run will make it possible for India and China to make a set of important strategic goals. Which basically means really what they don't really do. Now, I'm not saying that is the majority view, but it is a view that is held by some rather influential policymakers in Beijing, and particularly in the group that is moving close to power of the 18th Party Congress, people who are pretty close to Xi Jinping in terms of being foreign policy advisors. It's a realist, or at least pseudo-realist, way of understanding the world, which in my view often ends up in here. But it's important, I think, to be aware of that particular orientation. We can discuss this more later on, I'm sure we will. In terms of global issues, China's emphasis over the next generation will still be on technology and on trade. China's rise to great power status is different from anything that we've ever seen in the world before. Not because it is the first non-European country to rise to such status since the mid-18th century when my story began, but because it is by far the best integrated country that ever rises to this status internationally. Integrated, first and foremost in economic terms, but also increasingly because of international organizations, in political and diplomatic terms. China is far more integrated into the world economy today than what the United States was when it rose to global prominence in the late 19th and early 20th century. The degree to which the international drives China's domestic growth is something that is very often misunderstood. Because one thinks about the general East Asian model, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, you know, you pull yourself up into a position where you can transform yourself into an export-led dynamic economy. That is not what has happened in China. The driving part of China's modernization in a part of the economy that really matters, meaning what is predominantly export-led, most of the contributions there are international. And about 60% of China's of the capital that has gone into building China's export-driven industry, 60% of foreign direct investment comes from outside China itself. The similar figure for South Korea, when it was at its peak of industrial development around 1970 to 75, were about 2%. It is not your general East Asian model. It is a much more integrated model. Now, we can discuss afterwards what this means. Does that mean, by necessity, the absence of conflict? Of course not. I mean, anyone who studies the origins of the First World War will be very doubtful about, you know, economic interdependence meaning peace. So it does mean something in terms of what it actually tells us about, integration. And the level to which China always has to look at the international system in order to chart its own course forward. What is China's biggest challenge today? Well, in my view, it is very straightforwardly that given its level of development overall, China is very badly governed. And this is the point where some Indians start. And this is the point where some Indians start shaking their heads, not to mention some British people. What I mean by is that this general idea that is there of China being controlled from the top, being autocratic in a modernistic sense, is mainly a myth. I mean, it's mainly something that doesn't really work out when you look at how Chinese power has developed. China's enormous economic development is not something, in my view, that has happened primarily because of government planning and government interference. Very often it happens against us. The enormous levels of corruption, the difficulties with stealing power from the center to the provinces. My favorite example of this is that all of China still is on the same time zone, I mean, from the Korean border to Western Xinjiang. And if anyone who wants to do anything in Western Xinjiang, poor farmers would have to get up in the middle of the night to look after it. If anyone should behave politically correctly. It's also about the bureaucracy that really doesn't work very well, because there are so many uncertainties about what is party controlled and what is government controlled. And then finally, there is an enormous disregard for the rights and the opportunities of the people who have just been drawn into this enormous economic machine that China has developed into. The workers in the workers' space, which I think will be, over the next generation, the biggest challenge to political authority within China. And the fact that these people, increasingly active, have no legitimate outlet at all for their concerns, is something that is an enormous challenge for China in terms of its governance system. Not being able to deal with that successfully will mean leaving a time bomb within China's development more important to me than any foreign affairs concerns that we're talking about today. So of course, what is impacted by the other? And that's the reason why anyone who has an interest in China's development internationally also has to look at its development within its own country, and particularly the way that it is going. So that's what I'm trying to do today. I'm trying to look at some of the domestic and internal determinants of China's development, but I also try to give you a certain sense of where I want to go in order to begin to analyze, because we're really only at the beginning of this process, how the Chinese state, how Chinese society, and how Chinese international affairs have developed over the past 200 years. Thank you.